Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. I'm Dr. Keith Bueller. I'm going to be going through a short presentation adapted from an intro philosophy course that I used to teach. I wanted to present it here to preserve it and to get your thoughts on it. I'm using Richard Dawkins in this lecture as a jumping off point to discuss theism and atheism. I am an Orthodox Christian and a philosopher. I mostly study ethics and education, but I think that taking someone seriously like Dawkins, who's a popular sort of philosopher, debater, and an accomplished biologist, is worthwhile. And so I'll offer some comments and reflections at the end in somewhat of a cursory manner. Of course, there's many resources that can take you deeper, but I'm trying to be cover a lot of ground succinctly. So here goes. I've subtitled this presentation "Luck, Natural Selection, and the Anthropic Principle Explain Everything," and so probably there is no God. This is a very succinct summary of Dawkins' article. There's probably, or almost certainly, no God. Richard Dawkins was born in 1941. He grew up in the Church of England and lost his faith in his early teens and went on to a successful career in biology and ethology. So he is a working scientist. He is not an academic philosopher, but he turned into a polemicist against quote-unquote religion, religions of all kinds, but especially Christianity and Islam, when he wrote The Blind Watchmaker in 1986. His first book, The Selfish Gene, was a popular level scientific book about a gene-centered view of evolution rather than looking at macro traits. But he sort of, I suppose, had enough success in the popular level that he continued to write. He wrote Blind Watchmaker, arguing against the appearance of intelligent design, which is, just by the very fact of writing it, he's nodding to the fact that this is one of the best arguments for the existence of God, and therefore most deserving of some kind of refutation. He wrote The God Delusion in 2008, where the gloves came off. It's a much more aggressive attack on religious belief, faith, superstition, and so on. And it was, last time I checked, was still one of the number one bestsellers on Amazon in its category. His style, I would say he is a popular polemicist. He writes like a scientist, but he definitely has a poetic flair. I think that partly explains his popularity. He likes to wonder at the world. If you follow him on X, formerly Twitter, or read some of his articles or see his interviews, he's a very poetic, kind of a sentimental soul, even though he's a hard-bitten scientist and a rationalist. He says there's real poetry in the real world. Science is the poetry of reality. You can see sort of offering a alternative, you know, to this vision of science being cold and blank and mathematical and religion being sort of interesting and mysterious and fun. He thinks that natural selection explains everything that a God is supposed to explain, which makes God as a hypothesis unnecessary. I like this quotation. The scientific worldview is much more exciting, more poetic, more filled with sheer wonder than anything in the poverty-stricken arsenals of the religious imagination. Again, attacking religion at the level that many people object to atheism in being sort of bleak, and he's trying to counter that. In The God Delusion, which is a full book I won't attempt to summarize, but extremely succinct here, he says that there's almost certainly no God, and if that's the case, then it follows that anyone who thinks there is a God and in fact takes this seriously and organizes their whole life or their whole society around religion is inevitably operating under a delusion and going to cause all kinds of real societal problems. Countering, again, the probably more majority view that religion is the cause of great good in the world. And then from that it follows, if monotheism is the cause of evil, we should get rid of it. And someone might say, but are atheists immoral? Do atheists live imbalanced lives? Are they eggheads and, you know, they just do science all the time? Are they depressed or do they live in existential despair? And how do they have any intellectual fulfillment when they think about the briefness of human life, the inevitability of death, and all of these things? And he says in the third part of the book, tries to give a vision for how atheism can be moral, balanced, happy, and intellectually fulfilled. That's his most popular book in a very brief nutshell. Now, I'm going to skip this slide and maybe come back to it. The article, There Is Almost Certainly No God, is a little bit easier for us to tackle and is equally juicy, I would say, compared to the whole book. Here are some of the major claims. Supernaturalism is not opposed to naturalism. Supernaturalism, the religious worldview, he's saying, is not opposed to naturalism, a sort of scientific worldview. Supernaturalism is opposed to rationality itself. Supernaturalism is irrationality. And he does have this discussion about when and where science and religion overlap, and he's going to discuss the proper way to understand science's domain. He also says that the arguments for design and for God's existence are no good, using an example from Thomas Aquinas, and sort of, you know, dismissing that one. He says natural selection explains the appearance of design. There's not truly design, but there is the appearance of design, and natural selection explains it and everything else. Natural selection is neither chance, pure chance, nor pure design. It's not just nature operating sort of mindlessly, but it's not also not a mind that's doing selecting for a reason, for a purpose, with intelligence. It sort of explains that in-between space. And then he unfolds the anthropic principle, which we'll get into on the next bit. And the anthropic principle combined with natural selection give a, quote, complete and deeply satisfying explanation for everything that we see and know. So these are the major claims in the article. I'll give you a bit of a quote to taste it. You can probably read this for free online. He says, America, founded in secularism, notice countering the widespread belief that America is a Christian nation, or at least a deeply religious nation. 75% Christian last time I checked, and you know, something like 98% of American presidents have been Christian, Anglican, Episcopalian, Catholic, Protestant, or what have you. America, founded in secularism as a beacon of 18th century Enlightenment thinking, is becoming the victim of religious politics, a circumstance that would have horrified the founding fathers. He is British, by the way, but he's very popular in America. The political ascendancy today values embryonic cells over adult people. If you don't know about the embryonic cell controversy, it's the idea that little teeny tiny babies that are still, you know, single-celled virtually, that are frozen, as the idea that they have rights. And so he's criticizing this idea. It obsesses about gay marriage ahead of genuinely important issues that actually make a difference to the world. It gains crucial electoral support from a religious constituency whose grip on reality is so tenuous that they expect to be raptured up to heaven, leaving their clothes as empty as their minds. More extreme specimens actually long for a world war, which they identify as the Armageddon, that is to presage the second coming. So you can see the polemical style. He's not softening the tips there. Now, this sort of overlapping religion and science idea section explains the different approaches of Neville Chamberlain and Winston Churchill. Neville Chamberlain argued that we should appease moderate religion and fight against fundamentalism, people that are quote-unquote extreme in their religion. Winston Churchill said we should fight all religion, both moderate and fundamental. This is Dawkins' suggestion that we should do this. Quote, the fight for evolution is only one battle in a larger war, a looming war between supernaturalism on the one side and rationality on the other. So religious belief and religious believers are battling out over whether we're going to be reasonable or completely unreasonable. And so he doesn't think that moderate religion should be allowed. He also disagrees a bit with this idea of non-overlapping magisteria. I believe it's Stephen Jay Gould who said that science has its domain, the natural world and technology and so on, and religion has its domain, and they don't overlap, and they can coexist. And moderate religion, as long as it stays within its domain, won't actually interfere with science. And Dawkins does not like this. He says that if God is real, then there should be physical signs of his reality. And so we can test the hypothesis. He says a universe with a God would be a completely different kind of universe from one without. And so we have to look at the religious claims that do overlap with scientific claims, and if they are proven false, we can dismiss all of religion. That's the idea. As a Churchillian, he says science is opposed to all supernaturalism. Personal gods are different from these abstract notions of love or nature or goodness or even fancifully the laws of physics, which are sometimes presented as divine. He says that religious people are not atheists of a poetic disposition. They're a completely different breed. They're kind of committed to their irrationality. So what are the arguments for God's existence? This is a very brief section in his article. He says the traditional arguments for God's existence are easily demolished. If there is a first cause, like something that happened at the beginning of the Big Bang, it would be simple, not complex and statistically improbable, which the God hypothesis, he says, is complex and statistically improbable. The teleological argument is inferior to Darwinian natural selection. The world does look designed. And the teleological argument is the argument, telos means end or purpose or goal in Greek, and the teleological argument says that the universe has purposes and goals, that we seem to see planets forming over time such that they can be occupied by living beings, and solar systems form over time. You know, the universe goes from either completely hot or completely cold to having the proper mixture of heat and cold with the presence of a sun and so on. So we could talk about the stars. They're beautiful, right? There seems to be order and beauty in the universe. We can talk about the very existence or the emergence of human beings and say all of this looks like the game is rigged. It looks like somebody set this up. Okay, that's the teleological argument in very brief form. And here's his response. Natural selection explains all of these appearances of design. So we don't need to posit that there is a designer that's actually doing the designing. He also picks on Thomas Aquinas, you know, and he says the argument from gradation in Aquinas' five ways is the fourth way, and he dismisses it. I think that is not even worth addressing because his summary of it is so short. He doesn't quite do it justice. But you'll notice that if you have read Aquinas's five ways in the Summa Theologica, it's in the Prima Pars, the first part, section two or article two and question three. It's available for free online again. Aquinas makes this objection that it would be superfluous to suppose that what can be accounted for by a few principles has been produced by many principles. And it seems that everything we see in the world can be accounted for by other principles, supposing God does not exist. For all natural things can be reduced to one principle, which is nature itself, and all voluntary things can be reduced to one principle, which is human reason or will. So what Aquinas is saying here, he doesn't believe this, but he's offering this as an objection to his belief. What he's saying is that everything, you know, make a big long list of things that happen, stars collide, or stars go supernova, planets collide, or asteroids. Skyscrapers get built, trees blossom forward. Make a big long list, and then you start to categorize them. All the things that happen because of natural law go into one bucket, and all the things that happen because of human reason or will, building a skyscraper, the writing of Romeo and Juliet, and so on and so forth, are all due to human will. So there's nothing left that needs to be explained by God. Everything on the list can be put into one of those two buckets, and there's nothing left over. And he'll give a response to this. I'll respond to that at the end. Still summarizing Dawkins, the origin of life can be explained by the anthropic principle. What is this? The anthropic principle is a bit hard to understand on your first go. I remember my students always looking at me a little bit sideways, like a dog hearing a high-pitched sound when I tried to explain the anthropic principle. So if this doesn't work for you on the first try, please do look it up elsewhere as well. The anthropic principle is essentially the idea that given that human beings have emerged in the universe and that we are curious and rational, given that we somehow got there, then it necessarily must be the case that there are certain things about the universe that would allow human beings to emerge in the first place. And so one of the answers to this deep question of why do human beings exist is going to be unnecessary. We don't actually need an answer for that because we know that the universe is the kind of place that can allow for human beings to exist. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here to ask the question. So it's a kind of a bit of a judo, I think. It's a bit of a flip of the question, saying we don't actually need an answer for that question because the very fact that we exist and can ask the question tells us something about the universe. So if that sounds a little circular to you, then, you know, think about it a bit more. Here's a next quote from Dawkins. Contrary to what is sometimes alleged, evolution is a predictive science. If you pick any hitherto unstudied species and subject it to minute certainty, any evolutionist will confidently predict that each individual will be observed to do everything in its power in the particular way of the species, plant, herbivore, carnivore, nectivore, or whatever it is, to survive and propagate the DNA that rides in it. This is a prediction you would expect on the basis of evolution, that things want to survive and things want to reproduce. And here's another prediction that evolutionary science makes. We won't be around long enough to test the prediction, but we can say with great confidence that if a comet strikes the Earth and wipes out the mammals, a new fauna will rise to fill their shoes, just as the mammals filled those of the dinosaurs 65 million years ago. And the range of parts played by the new cast of life's drama will be similar in broad outline, though not in detail, to the roles played by the mammals and the dinosaurs before them and the mammal-like reptiles before the dinosaurs. The same rules are predictably being followed in millions of species all over the globe and for hundreds of millions of years. Such a general observation requires an entirely different explanatory principle from the anthropic principle that explains one-off events like the origin of life or the origin of the universe by luck. That entirely different principle is natural selection. So I skipped a section in the article here, but he said the anthropic principle explains the origin of life. We would not be here to ask the question of the origin of life if life didn't originate, but life did originate. And so here we are. So that mystery is kind of explained, or at least we don't know how it happened necessarily, lightning or spontaneous evolution or alien seeds or whatever, but we know that it must have happened because here we are. Again, a bit circular, but he also says that the anthropic principle explains the origin of the universe. If there were no origin of the universe, then there would not be any people around to wonder about it. And so we must live in a universe such that it has an origin. And we don't necessarily need to know how it came about. That's the anthropic principle. It kind of does a little bit of uno reverso on the very questions that are attempting to be answered. So with anthropic principle, we get the origin of life, the origin of the universe, by luck or by some unknown cause. And with the with natural selection, we get an explanation of how life emerged, evolved, and filled the planet such that it's full of people like us who are watching YouTube videos or going to college, becoming scientists, and so on. That, in brief, is his answer to how atheism provides a satisfying explanation for everything. So let's talk about some of these points. The Edward Fazer article from the beginning, let me see if I can find it, argues that there are these things called brute facts, okay? If reality itself is intelligible to the human mind, if it's able to be understood, then that means that there are explanations for things. And these explanations refer back to previous truths, right? So truth A is explained by truth B, and truth B may be further explained by truth C. And you can make a big long list of explanations that build on each other, but at the end of that chain, when you get to truth X, Y, and Z, for example, truth Z is going to be a brute fact. There's going to be no further explanation for that truth because it's the thing that explains everything else, okay? Let's call that a brute fact. A brute fact is something that explains other things and has itself no further explanation. So we both agree, Dawkins and I, that there are brute facts and that there are explanations for things. We disagree on which is a better candidate for a brute fact. Is it mind or matter? He says the brute fact is matter or maybe some, you know, laws of nature. And those explain everything else, including the existence of human minds. And I would say that the brute fact is better supposed to be a mind that can create matter, just like I can create something out of clay, God can create something out of matter, and he can create matter itself out of nothing. So he also suggests that the brute fact should be simple. The thing that explains everything else should be simple and not complex. And I'm not sure that that is accurate. Complex causes have complex effects. A very complicated machine, assembly line, factory can produce a very complicated car. But it's not the case that simple machines can produce, you know, a car or a giant tractor, caterpillar. God is, on the Christian view, extremely simple in one sense, but he's also an infinite being. He has glory, he has thoughts, he has desires, he has plans. It's very complex, so it would make sense that if he's the brute fact, the thing that explains everything else without needing to be explained further, that he would be able to create a complex universe like the one that we live in. Another possible question or objection to the idea of natural selection is, although Dawkins puts it forward as the sort of in-between space between pure nature, which is luck or chance, and pure selection, which is mind or design, we could challenge that. And we could say, I think that, you know, natural selection is sort of a contradiction in terms. It's like jumbo shrimp. if it's natural, it's not selected, and if it's selected by a human being or an angel or a god, then it's not natural in that sense. It's not merely mechanical. And so just waving your hands and saying that natural selection does not require the existence of a mind or a designer is not sufficient. Another response, some comments on purpose or directionality. This is Aquinas' response to his own objection. If you assume that there is no divine mind at the beginning of the cosmos, overseeing the cosmos, then you can look at individual objects and systems within nature and perhaps explain them without reference to mind. For example, If you look at the a forest, and at one point it was very small, at another point it's very big because it's gone through many seasons of reproduction and growth and new trees taking root, and then at a third time it's very small again, maybe because of wildfires or because of migration of animals, changes the ecology of that system. So we can talk about this and explain it with as something that just happened naturally and that nobody designed it. No human beings went in there, tried to make it big or small. But there also seems to be this other thing, the directionality or the purpose of the whole of nature. So that directionality can't be explained without reference to some mind setting it in motion. And I'll give you an analogy to explain this after I read Aquinas' reply to his own objection. He says, since nature works for a determinate end under the direction of a higher agent, whatever is done by nature must needs be traced back to God as to its first cause. So also whatever is done voluntarily must be traced back to some higher cause other than human reason or will, since these can change or fail. For all things that are changeable and capable of defect must be traced back to an immovable and self-necessary first principle, as was shown in the body of the article. So the analogy you might use to make this point a bit more visible is, suppose that there's a bus, and the bus is going from Nevada, one end of Nevada to the next. We don't know where it came from. It's coming roughly from the direction of California, and we don't know where it's going. But we are on the bus, and the bus is nature in this analogy. All of the things that happen inside the bus, like a seatbelt clicking and unclicking, this is going to be done by a human being. Or the pushing on the gas pedal, that's going to be done by a human being. Or the air molecules circling around inside the bus, that's going to be done by nature. Or the fact that there's gravity taking place in the bus, that's going to be done by nature. But you can ask the further question, why is the bus itself going anywhere? And that would have to be explained by reference to something outside the bus. The bus driver and the people in it were in California, and they wanted to go somewhere. They wanted to go to Texas, okay? And they got in the bus and they left. So to unpack that analogy, you would say, yes, there's purpose in the universe that can be explained, both hypotheses fit, can be explained by natural law, natural processes. But why is there nature in the first place? And why is it going somewhere? Why is it directed towards certain ends? Like I said, the development of planets that can sustain life, at least one that we know of, the development of the human race, and so on. So this is something that Dawkins doesn't necessarily fully address. A third response would be to look at the existence of minds. We said there's two possible brute facts. The brute fact, let's say, the cause of the universe, which has no further cause, whatever was there before the Big Bang, whatever caused the Big Bang, it's either mind or matter. But that's not really two neutral hypotheses, because we are minds. You who are listening and I who am talking, we are thinking about this because we are more than just matter. We are minds, and if we have some inside knowledge of what that first cause might be, then we could, for example, talk to that brute fact, pray to that brute fact. We might actually receive a response from that brute fact. If God wants to actually connect with us and be known by us, then it's not just that he's sitting there as some concept waiting to be discovered. He is pursuing us as our creator and our king and our ruler. So if we were just matter, then you couldn't make this argument, A, because we couldn't think, and B, because we wouldn't have any inside knowledge as to what the origin of the universe might be. But we do. We are persons, like God is a person. And this brings me to some of the fundamental, what I call fundamental mysteries, some of the big questions that Dawkins uses luck to answer. Let's suppose there's at least five mysteries. And I'm borrowing this a bit from another philosopher. His name escapes me at the moment. I'll put it in the comments if it comes back to me. But he says there's four, at least five, possibly fundamental mysteries. Why is there something rather than nothing? Why does anything exist? Secondly, given that there's existence, why is it ordered? Why isn't there just, I've got this beautiful background of a stellar landscape of sort of the background of the stars. Why isn't there just a bunch of matter, dust, solar wind, just stuff for thousands, for millions of light years? Why isn't there just random stuff? Why isn't the universe a big random assortment of nothingness? So even if there is something rather than nothing, it's not a given that something would be ordered into a complex and beautiful structured cosmos. But there is order. And given that there's being and that there's order, why is there life? Again, if you assume being in order, you still don't necessarily have to have living organisms, bacteria, insects, algae, all of these things. Fourthly, given that there is being in order and life, why are there rational beings like you and me? Why are there these towering intellects and artists and poets and scientists and philosophers? Why is it the case that we can long so deeply for love and connection and grieve so deeply over loss and wonder about eternity? Why do we exist? Even if there's a good explanation for the order and the being of the universe. And the possible fifth one is, why is there morality? You can imagine that rationality is sort of a mechanical, logical functioning of the mind, and that in some other possible world, people exist and they think, but they don't do evil and feel sorrow and regret and contrition. They don't do good and self-sacrifice and love. They don't work for others, work in cooperative systems. You can imagine that there is a rational race that has no morality. And yet here we are. We are, I would say, our primary feature as human beings is that we are moral beings. So let's look at the answers for these fundamental questions on theism. Well, God explains all of them. Why is there something rather than nothing? Because God simply exists and has always existed, and he chose to make the created order. Why is that created order orderly? Because God is orderly. And why is there life? Because God is alive. He's a living being. He's life itself for other things, but he is living. He's alive. Why is there rationality? Because God is rational. St. John the Apostle says that in the beginning was the Logos, and the Logos was with God, and the Logos was God. Logos is word, or also rationality, order, meaning. So God is a rational being and made a rational cosmos, and some of the creatures in it themselves have their own rationality, a little spark of the divine mind, so to speak. And why is there morality? Of course, God is moral. He loves justice and hates injustice. He loves the good and hates the bad, despises wicked behavior, the oppression of the innocent, lying, cheating, stealing, pride, all of it. So on atheism, why is there being? Why is there something rather than nothing? This is luck. It's unknown. It's chance. Why is it orderly? Also unknown. There's natural laws, you could say, but why are there natural laws? Luck or unknown, that's the anthropic principle. Why is there life? Still no good scientific, non-theological hypothesis for the origin of life on this planet or anywhere else. why is there rationality? Now evolution comes in, natural selection comes in to save the day and say, well, given life, natural selection is going to produce complex rational beings, let's say. And why is there morality? Again, some sort of story can be told about how we evolved to cooperate and this turned into morality and so on. But the first three are a bit hand-waving. And so this is the one response to someone like Dawkins is to say that if you want to talk about intellectually satisfying and complete explanations, God sort of gives us the complete package of he is himself mysterious, but he explains all these other mysteries and indeed gives us purpose and order to our individual lives. And that brings us to the final point of revelation. Dawkins does not discuss the notion that God actually reveals himself to human beings in our deepest mind or deepest heart. But that's, of course, where this discussion should start, because we don't believe in God as some sort of philosophical crutch to explain things. We believe in him because he reveals himself to us. And even though our hearts are darkened by sin and passions, our personal failings make it actually harder to see true things, obvious truths, things that our friends might say, wow, you really have this problem. And I say, what? I don't even see it, right? Because I'm corrupted. but the first thing that God does to reveal himself is not, you know, write scripture books, but he speaks to prophets, and the prophets themselves know God and have a personal experience of him and share what God has revealed to them, to others, and to the world. So you might yourself have personal experiences of God speaking to you, leading you, letting you know his love and care for you, or you might not, but that is in fact possible, and many people believe in God because of their relationship with him, not because of fancy arguments. We have scripture over time. Some of these prophets wrote down the revelation that God gave them, and this becomes a sort of objective, written public record of some previous revelations. And we have not just in the distant past, but we have present day living examples of people who are extremely holy and who are in touch with God and are able to help us when we are dense and when we don't understand what he's doing or how to live or how to pray. So all of these are ways of getting to know God in addition to or instead of pure rationalizing. I don't believe in my mother because of arguments. I believe in her because she gave birth to me and we have a relationship and have had for many years. I don't believe in my wife because of pure rationalizing. I believe in her because I met her at one point and we got to know each other and I thought she was the greatest thing. So this is closer to how we get to know God. We meet him, maybe he introduces himself to us and we have to learn about him, but we have to get to know him, but it's not purely rational. And this is something not often discussed by atheists. They'll talk about religious superstition and irrationality of religious people, and superstition is indeed a problem for religious people and for non-religious people. Superstition is a human vice that you can find in the intelligent, the unintelligent, the average, the religious, the non-religious. You can find it everywhere. It's an intellectual vice. But they don't talk about how necessarily our rationality is a wee bit tainted by not just cognitive bias and our emotions and the brainwashing of our culture, perhaps, the brainwashing of our scientific department or our family or our friend group. These things are definitely real problems, but we have even a deeper problem, our personal defects that I mentioned before. So we need help. We need help. We need God to reveal himself to us. We need him to take the first step. And thankfully, he does do that and has done that and can do that again. Finally, we need to be humble to accept that we are not God, no matter how advanced our technology, AI, longevity, science, food production, no matter how advanced all these things get, we are never going to be our own source of life, our own source of survival. We're never going to be able to fend off death completely. Even if longevity takes off, there's always accidents, nuclear war, murder. And so we just have to accept our place, that we are not going to climb onto God's throne. And when we do this, we begin to accept the help that he's extending to us. And we suddenly find that there's a lot of evidence. So just going back to the major claims of the article, I've tried to give a non-polemical and brief case that Christianity in particular is more rational and satisfying as an explanation of the whole universe, the existence of order, life, rationality, and so on. This is a point I didn't make. Science and religion maybe do overlap the same way that we could give a psychological account of why people play tennis, and we could give a sort of physiological account of what's going on inside the human body when we play tennis. Immediate things like, you know, what coffee is made of is compatible, it's sort of complementary, it's a different dimension from ultimate things like why people like coffee and why we drink it so much and spend so much money on it. Immediate things like why does the universe exist? What is the purpose for me in my life of living and of being good or repenting of evil? These questions are ultimate things. The immediate questions of what am I made of and how do I, you know, build this machine or how do I invent this new technology? These things are compatible. They're really two dimensions of the same thing. Arguments for design are pretty good. The appearance of design is overwhelming, and the best explanation for that appearance is that there is real design. Using natural selection, I would say, is either a neutral explanation. It's equally good, but no better, unless you assume atheism. If you assume atheism, natural selection just becomes an ad hoc explanation that, you know, it makes sense given atheism, but it doesn't actually support atheism if you're not starting with it. So that's my presentation on Dawkins and a few reflections on the existence of God, the sort of personal analogy that we actually connect with God more as a friend, a master, a king, someone who takes care of us, a parent, someone who leads us, a Lord. This is much more the way we connect with God rather than reasoning about him, although reasoning, you know, can be a fine help. If you want to take 60 seconds, think about a question or post a comment in the comm box, that would be great. I will respond to them, God being my helper. It could be an unrelated question or a thought or reaction or just a thank you to help the YouTube algorithm. Have a great day.